Now, before we begin this episode, I want you guys to please turn on your post notifications, subscribe to the InfoMinds channel, hit the bell icon and select all. This will send you alerts for our newest uploads and our community tab posts as well. Now, please, 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 I can't stress this enough. Hit the video with a like, please comment and share the video. That's going to help us promote our videos to a wider audience, and it's going to also help us grow the channel. And I want to thank everybody for their continued support. I want to thank all the other platforms that have been showing us support. And please like, share, comment, subscribe.
Yup, bless up, man. It's your boy Tabba New Yiddy. Y'all know I'm in here on my late night vibe getting my workout in. But I wanted to take the opportunity real quick to shout out my brother Titon. Titon Rosaveli, YTC, Yellow Top Crew, legendary. You know what I'm talking about? Hold your head, my brother. You know they can't keep a real one down forever. You've been down this road before and you came out 10 toes down. I salute you, my G. Positive vibes to you always. God bless you on your journey. See you when you get back. Holla at your boy.
Peace. Well, I want to welcome y'all to another episode of For the Culture, man. This episode is featuring Tition Rosavelli. Yo, Tition, tell the people a little bit about yourself, man, and where you from, bro.
I'm Tition Rosavelli, ex-co-leader of the YTC drug gang. I'm from New York City, New York, born and raised between Manhattan and the Bronx.
Give us a little background on your early childhood, if you don't mind.
I was born in Presbyterian Hospital. My mom migrated here from the Dominican Republic when she was 13. My pops, I don't know how he was when he migrated from Puerto Rico. One thing led to another, started dating, boom, bang, here I am. They got married. We moved to the Bronx. When I was 5 years old, they split up. My mom was 18 when she had me. We just moved around a lot. However, my first years, to like I was like 12, 13, was mostly in the Bronx. There was times when my mom used to split up with her boyfriend and we used to always end up in my grandmother's house. My grandmother lived on 109th and between Amsterdam and Broadway. For whatever time we spent over there, I used to go outside and socialize with the young kids from that neighborhood. That was that. We'd be there till another situation happens. Going into 88, one of them situations happened, and I was already 13 years old. I was like, you know what? I'ma just stay with grandma, man. She more stable, you heard?
What was it like growing up back and forth between the Bronx and Manhattan? Just paint a picture. What was the environment like?
81, 82 was when hip-hop was basically coming out, breakdancing, was happy, electric boogie. That type of shit was going on. Bronx had nothing but a bunch of vacant lots. I was just having fun by being creative, you know what I'm saying? I was that vibe in the Bronx. Manhattan, my grandmother's from the Upper West Side, extends further, but like where we basically roam from 100th Street to 110th Street. In Manhattan, it was like these kids was just, they was chilling. They were in Manhattan, their moms was buying them sneakers every 6 weeks. They was getting Easter clothes on time. They getting a vacation or going to summer camp. They get lunch money. They play sports. They dance. That was the vibe like that. I was going in between those two things more in my younger years, leaning towards the Bronx, though.
At what age did you first start hustling and really start bumping around in the streets, and what circumstances led you down that path?
I was a few months shy, from my 14th birthday. I was technically 13, 165th Street at Walton Avenue. I saw my first crack right there. And I overheard my mom's talking on the phone to a friend, telling her that she ain't had no money for Easter clothes for us. That year, I wasn't really feeling that. I was 13. Great Adventures was the wave that year. Easter and shit. Basically, I ain't had no patience, and I was too young to get working papers. And so when I'm going to my pop's block to chill, I see my man Ed. So I'm like, yo, where you get that from? You know, I'm selling crack. That was it. I was like, yo, put me on. Plug me in with the people he was working for, and they put me on, and that's how it started.
And so he plugs you with his peoples that he was hustling for. Okay, so now you in the game. What type of money was y'all seeing on a daily basis? Like, what type of numbers was those blocks doing?
It was a dude and a girl. They was partners, and we was working for them. I was supposed to make $50 off of every 100 pack. We sell the $3 bottles. I went like two or three times with them to go re-up. we used to go to Broadway. It was the Hicks, the Dominican Hicks, the ones that migrated from over there over here, hustling them niggas don't know no English. I used to translate because I speak Spanish. I'm Dominican and Puerto Rican. I'm really more into my Dominican culture because that's the culture I grew up with then. So in the course of translating, I learned the prices. Then I used to help them bottle up. Within a week, I already knew how to do this shit by myself. All I needed was a place. But ironically, him and the girl had some type of discrepancy. I don't know the details to it, but they split up and I went with the girl and she made me a partner. But that shit lasted for like a month. Right around that time was when we moved back with my grandmother.
Can you tell us, when did you meet Chango for the first time? And how did you guys start building the relationship that you guys wind up having?
So when I used to break night, I used to be coming back home. I used to bump into Chang. He was in the same situation like me. He was trying to get some bread. One thing led to another. We came up with the bright idea of copping some work together. And that's how that shit started.
Now, Titon, can you tell us about Maque Tumba? Who is he and where was he from and what role did he play in your adolescent life?
Maque Tumba was the big homie, man. That was my big homie. That was Jack's big homie. He used to tell people we was his son. I used to be proud of that. Yeah, Maque Tumba basically was a Dominican from the Upper West Side that got patched in the Lower East Side and made it do what it do, man. Get busy, humble, fly, charismatic, but get busy, get money. Had the rollies, everything, whips, cribs, all of that, man. And he was down there in the late 80s, early 90s.
And Titon, can you explain to the people who Coho was?
Coho is a get busy nigga, man. Fly, funny, joking around all the time. You know what I'm saying? But a real gunman.
His claim to fame at the beginning was his dancing, though. He used to be doing electric boogie. He was super fly with that shit. They call him Boogie Ralph and all that. Gore was Maque Tumba's right-hand man, his guardian angel, so to speak. They were both from the hood, too.
After Maque Tumba and Coho survived that first attempt on their life, where they were severely injured, what type of beef was they into that those guys was really gunning for them like that? Was it over territory, or was it some type of business deal that might have went bad? Like, what did they have going on that the shooters was on them like that?
They was fighting a war within each other. Maque basically went to the Lower East Side and was working with some dudes and then basically got big. The dudes, they was on some retiring shit, but they still owned the blocks and they was giving the work to Maque at a certain price, a little bit more higher. Maque came across his own dope connects. They started giving him work at the low, so he started taking that work and that started like the beef, and they would beef, and then they squashed that after a few murders. The beef started again, and then they'll squash it after a few murders. Like, it's just crazy. That shit was going on for a few years and shit. Maque just taking over territory and doing what he want down there. They feel it some type of way, and I wasn't personally involved with none of that shit, but.
And now I know this is a touchy subject, my brother. When Coho and Maque Tumba survived that first attempt on their life, and then for them to be killed such a short time after, how did they get caught slipping so soon after? Like, as soon as they got out the hospital, like, they, you know what I mean?
As for why they came gunning for them so hard after the first attempt, unsuccessful attempt, rather, because they knew, bro, that this shit was about to get serious, you know what I'm saying? Super more serious, and that these dudes was going to come back and do some ill shit. So they had to move fast on that. It was an internal. Everybody knew each other with an internal war. So everybody knew how one another moved. They knew that Maque and them niggas was gonna come back aggressively, so they had to move on it. However, Maque wanted to do this shit a certain type of way. Coho just wanted to execute on the streets, wherever. Maque wanted to grab people and torture and make them feel shit. That shit delayed them. They got caught because the op moved quicker. They caught them slipping. They killed both of them at the same time.
After Maque Tumba was murdered, you and Chango formed the YTC, aka the Yellow Top Crew. Why did you guys choose that name?
The guy that we used to give the dope to moved from the west side of Manhattan to the east side, 215, between Lexington and 3rd. We used to give him packs of crack. But in the little building that he was hustling, there was another guy selling yellow. See, on the east side, they use brands. If you use black, nobody else could use black. And whoever used whatever color, nobody else could use no other color. There was another guy that was selling yellow. One day he seen us and he asked us for weight. We really wasn't into selling weight, so we talked him into getting packs. So we was giving him packs. One day the people from the neighborhood noticed that he was getting packs from us, and we was from the hood, so they pressed him and ended up beating him up and scared them away. So we asked them to give us the keys to the room, and we were gonna take over the spot. We took over the spot with a whole West Side team on the east side, and we opened up with his yellow, and we did numbers with that. That's when we first started getting a lot of money. And yellow came about because, you know, the tops is yellow, yellow top crew. That was it, and then we put different meanings to it. But that's how the name came about.
Titon, it was said that the YTC controlled a 12-block radius on Manhattan's Upper West Side at its peak. Now, how difficult and dangerous was it to run an organization of that size with you guys being that young?
In hindsight, it was very dangerous. It took a lot of wisdom to make the right decisions, knowledge to more or less know what to do in certain situations. But at the time, we wasn't even thinking about it like that. We were just living our life. That was part of our lifestyle, so it didn't really seem difficult. As far as the danger, it was extremely dangerous. But again, we didn't feel that way because we were just living like that, you know?
Have you ever became a victim of some of the violence due to your lifestyle choices?
A month before I got locked up for the YTC case in 1994, there was a hit put out on and on Chang too. Matter of fact, I got shot in the arm and in the head, and a cop got shot in the process. That was the first time that the violence touched us. It was a scary experience. It was confusing, because at the moment, I didn't know where the fuck that shit came from, who had the audacity, and being that we already had different beefs on different fronts, it was confusing at the moment, but we figured it out within 36 hours where it came from and all that, and handled that. At the end of the day, nobody in our team ever got killed. I'm kind of proud for that, that none of my dudes ever got killed in the process. If you entering that lifestyle, the odds are going to be stacked against you. That's basically how that boiled down to. We got to be lucky every day. Authority figures and, you know, the law enforcement, however you want to call it, you know what I'm talking about, police, them. They just gotta be lucky one time. We gotta be lucky every day. Every day we gotta dodge shit. We gotta dodge hitmans that are being hired by drug dealers that wanna take our spot, or people that are jealous and shit like that, you know? It's a very dangerous profession that we had chose, but at the moment, at the time, we didn't see it that way. But like I said earlier, in hindsight, I'd be like, whoof, and every day I give thanks that I survived those crack wars and that whole era. Today, the murder rate in New York City is like 400, maybe reaches 500. Back then, it was 2,500 bodies a year versus 480 to almost 500 today. It was very active in the streets on that heavy metal tip.
In the original YTC documentary, there was a cat named Raymond. Can you explain to the viewers who was Raymond and what was your connection with Raymond?
Raymond grew up in the same building my grandmother had an apartment in. He's older by a few years from me. I grew up with the dude. We ended up starting doing business together when we got a little older in the streets and shit. He took a chance and gave us the first brick, our first kilo.
And it was also public knowledge that you and Raymond had a falling out. You know what I mean? That resulted in you being shot in the arm and head.
Yeah, man, we had a falling out, man. Unfortunately, that's how it is in this type of business, man. You start out as friends, end up as enemy type shit. He felt we owed him something because he took that shot on us. You know what I mean? This is my theory, is what I came up with. You know what I mean? Because I never sat down and asked him what was the reason for his shit. But we were the one that put in that work in the east side. We were the one that took that block in the east side. He ain't had nothing to do with none of these blocks with the retail operation. He gave us weight. He never voiced that, but we could tell from body language and demeanor and little whispering from here and there. However, he wanted to put dope on our block. He stopped fucking with the coke and shit, because we stopped dealing with him because we found out that he was giving us prices that was like astronomical. So he wanted to put dope. He got into the dope game. He wanted to put dope in our block because he knew we ain't deal with dope. And we wasn't with it. And the reason we wasn't with it is because we know what type of dude he is, conniving and all that. So, you know, we knew he was going to try to just get close to us and study. And before you know it, he was going to try to bust a move like the move that he ended up trying to bust, which was putting out those hits on me and Chang.
Chango also spoke on a situation that took place with Raymond when, you know, it was time where he had to pay the piper. He had to pay for his disloyalty. Whatever happened of him after that situation, like whatever happened with Raymond?
After I got hit, I really didn't know where that shit came from. Within the matter of hours and shit, you know, police is grimy like that. They basically laid it out who did it. And then we realized that they caught one of the shooters. He told it on everybody else that participated in the hit. Once I found out that, we got on our job. He wasn't going to be able to just do that and get away with it. But being that we was running at one time in the same circle and we all grew up with each other, so we knew our teams and shit, it wasn't easy for us personally to get close to him. So floor nigga from PR and basically solved that situation and shit. He ended up getting shot a few times and shit. I was actually inspecting this Beamer that I had just bought. Chang saw the opportunity and he executed the plan. I came back from inspecting the car at the tail end of the situation. And that was that. Then not too long after that, the YTC indictment dropped, probably like 10 months, a year after that. He ended up getting locked up too for some other shit and all that. He up north right now.
What was y'all connection to Sadat X? And what's his link to the YTC?
Sadat X, Brad Nubian, we grew up to that shit. That was popping out there at that time. That shit was moving in the streets. Music, radio, them niggas was doing their thing. Sadat X is part of the Brad Nubians. He lived, ironically, right there on 106 between Columbus and Amsterdam. He had a black Wrangler Jeep. He'd come through playing his music, chilling. You gotta understand, our hood is like the Upper West Side. To the naked eye, the classy neighborhood. I'm not saying it's not, but you know, cut, you got the hood bubbling in the underground type shit. Anyways, Sadat X lived there. He was in out of place. He just happened to live where we had a block at. He signed a dude that was working with us named Sean Black. He signed him to that Wild Cowboy situation that he had going in like 96. It was cool, you know, to have like a, you know, quote unquote celebrity in the hood and shit.
Can you give us a detail about who JL was and what position he played?
JL is Jose Luis. We should just call him JL for short. And I say he was co-leader of the Red Top Crew, kid from the neighborhood. One of the super colors. Very influential, very well-liked.
Now, Chango said you was known sometimes to be a jokester and a prankster.
Being humorous, yeah, I get that a lot. A lot of people say that I have a great sense of humor. But I grew up snapping, man. That's what dudes did for rec back then. That was one of the things that they did for rec was snap. We ain't had no money, so I ain't had no fly gear. So I used to be the bun of the joke. So I had to learn how to either snap well or fight. I did both. I learned how to snap well and how to fight.
Public information that you guys had got indicted and spent a lot of time in prison, man. Let's get into that. The time that you got locked up with the YTC conspiracy and all that, was that your first time touching Rikers Island and going through the prison system, or had you had already been there and done that by that time?
That's my first real pinch. I got arrested a bunch of times, charged with all types of different shit, but you know, all that shit would be dismissed. My first real pinch when the YTC shit happened, and as far as my experience in the jail, jail is not a place to be anyway. Personally, I ain't have no bad experience in jail. For being in jail, I was alright, I was good, I was chilling. I ain't saying that shit because I want anybody to go through, but you see, the thing of the matter is that it wasn't about I could make it or not make it. It was about not being able to be there for my family, missing all types of milestones for my children, nervous about the fact that my grandmother's gonna pass while I'm locked down. You don't want that shit to happen. You don't want your family to pass away, period. But it's not when you can't even be there for them. That's the shit that kills real niggas, you understand? Fortunately for me, I was chilling. I ain't saying that shit on some Superman shit. Just how it turned out, you know what I mean? I was ready for the worst, hoping for the best. Things always worked out good. I did my bit, but a lot of shit happened to people that ain't know how to move. They wind up in other people's business, and that shit cost them heavily. Shit could get ugly for a person that don't know how to do their time correctly, you know what I mean?
Wild Cowboys and the Jerry Curl crew, those is cats from Manhattan. Did you have any interactions with them?
Wild Cowboys, we had an interaction with them one time, but we didn't even realize that it was with the Wild Cowboy at the time, and they ain't know who we was either. It was just some situation that happened in the club. I don't even know exactly who was there as far as them. But I officially met them in prison. When we got locked up on the YTC case, I ended up in Brooklyn House, CMC House in Brooklyn, and Pacualito was there. And then he left and Danny came, and then Danny left and then Lenny came, and then Platano, and then they left. Yeah, I met like the main niggas, the ones that went to trial and blew and all of that. And them dudes is lights out, man. You know what I mean? They gave them dudes numbers that no human person could do. Like 158 years, 130 years, and 60-something years and shit like that. You know what I mean? So, you know, I hope them dudes get some rhythm or something. You know what I mean? An appeal or something, man. Shout out to them, man. Fat Danny. Shout out to Fat Danny. and shit. That's my guy. Personally, I built a relationship with him while bidding.
Did you ever experience police trying to extort you guys when y'all was getting money? Did you ever go through any of those type of situations yourself?
I guess you could say when you really break it down, technically, I had a cop on the payroll. We ended up having a cop on the payroll. It was like he'd give us information on what's popping, on if our name is shaking, and you know, whatever he heard that had anything to do with us that he felt that we needed to know or would want to know. And he had access to that information, he'll pass it on, but, you know, he wasn't really breaking and bending it back for that shit, you know what I mean? But it started on some, the nigga was running around just taking people packs. He had a dude from his hood that used to hang out in our hood and used to, like, let him know, like, yeah, yeah, right there. So they used to take the packs, not make arrests, just take the packs, you know what I'm saying? And that shit add up, that's money, you know what I'm saying? And they used to resell that shit downtown or whatever. So he was technically extorting niggas.
Lynn Stewart, the activist / lawyer / YTC attorney. Did she represent you as well in that case? And when I say the name Lynn Stewart, what does that mean to you?
Lynn Stewart is my street mother, my guardian angel. That's what she served for us. She didn't represent me in the YTC case technically because you can't do that, it's illegal. She was assigned to Chang and her son was assigned to me. But it was still the same shit, you know what I mean? It's like she, you know, the information, what's going on, like she's not, she really looked at us as her kid to the extent that far as like, you know, she had love for us and wished us the best and helped us whichever way possible while trying to advise us to go the right route. That's how she was, man. That's who she is, man. That's who she was. Rest in peace. That's what the name Lynn Stewart means to me.
Bro, this is a little urban myth, man. But they say that some of the actors who played smokers in the movie New Jack City was actually people that was really actually getting high, that was happening to be customers of y'all's. Is that true?
I can't emphatically state that, yeah, that's true, but I wouldn't be surprised because the film was filmed blocks away from us. So if they happen to use real customers from the neighborhood, there's a strong possibility that some of those customers used to cop from us.
Now, during the YTC run, did y'all ever hear about Preacher and his crew, or what kind of reputation did they have in Harlem?
There was rumors, some shit about Preacher talking about he gonna come through, snatches up and all that. I don't know how true that shit is, but yeah, nah, I definitely heard about Preacher and all that. It was running around uptown and all that, but that shit never affected us. They ain't never come downtown or none of that. We ain't never been stuck up like or extorted, like none of that. I ain't saying that shit on no Superman shit like we was untouchable and all that. It just ain't happened, bro. That's it. It just ain't happened.
The reason I asked about the Preacher crew, because, you know, every generation got their boogeyman. You know what I'm saying? Like you guys had with the, if I'm not mistaken, I think his name was Santana.
Now that's a fact. Everybody, every generation, I have a boogeyman and somebody that's running around. And yeah, 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 Santana, Sammy Santana. Yeah, yeah, we got rid of the boogeyman quick, though.
What do you think about dudes that go on these social media platforms and go and talk crazy and put themselves in predicaments to where just writing checks that they ass can't cash and shit, things of that nature, man? Law enforcement is using clips and videos and things from people's social media footage against them in the court of law. You know, you get caught in the moment and you do things and say shit that you might not wholeheartedly mean, but you just caught in the moment. And you know, this generation is camera phones, is world stars, this is this and that. What's your take on dudes just putting themselves out there like that, and then once they do get jammed up, oh, the world is telling on me, when they basically really just telling on themselves?
Man, listen, that's why there's not a lot of there's pictures, but there could have been much more. A lot of whip pictures, it could have been a lot more pictures of us back in the day, but we ain't believing that shit, man. We ain't believing documenting our lifestyle because we knew that our lifestyle was illegitimate. So for me to see these individuals do that shit on social media, I look at them like, these niggas is a bunch of bozos. After I see shit like that, I'm like, these niggas is not nothing. After that, it's like they whole shit. If I was paying attention to them, I'm not going to pay attention to them no more after I see that dumb shit, because nobody, you know, just go incriminate themselves like that, man, just for the hell of it, man, you know what I mean? And don't get me wrong, man, we done took pictures with guns and all that, but 99% of the time, man, we going to rip that shit up and throw that shit away. We just wanted to see how that shit looked, you know what I mean? Because we knew what it was. I was on the island first day, you know, I got pictures of the Beamer and this, that, and the other, you know, regular shit, young nigga shit, you know what I mean? Flashy, weak, jail, we go, this is what it is, we only got memory. And Danny was like, yo, my nigga, they can fuck around, search yourself, find them pictures, take that shit right, and put that shit right in your trap. And how you going to justify that you bought a Beamer, nigga? You 19 years old when you got arrested. Or fuck, you got Beamer money from? So I threw them shits away. I say all that to say that CNE dude do that shit on social media, I'm like, these niggas is clowns, man. That shit is some clown shit. That shit is not wide at all, you dig?
How did you feel at such a young age in your first bid, spending your time in Elmira, which is also known as Gladiator School, man? What was that like?
The unknown is scary, bro. My first time up north, naturally I was nervous, but I took it on head on, man. Thank God I survived the experience. But every day when that cell door locked for the night, I gave thanks to God for making it through one more day, because shit is real in them jails, man. If you get caught up in the wrong shit, you may not make it home. Either because you bodied somebody protecting your life, or somebody took your life. I just stood out the way, bro, did my time as productive as possible. Went and got my GED, learned a few trades, did my bid with the focus of coming home, being that I knew I had a number that I could get to, you know? Even though it was long, I knew that there was a possibility of me getting back to the street, so my focus was getting back home and doing my time as productive as possible.
Now, T-Tone, we know you lived a colorful life, man, so far. What would you say are some of the things that might keep you up at night? Some things that you might be like, damn. You know what I'm saying? Now, we ain't trying to turn this into the get indicted interview or nothing, but all I'm saying is, what's some of your biggest regrets, man, more or less?
Yo, I ain't even trying to sound cocky or none of that shit, but I don't really lose sleep about none of that, man. I'm not proud. I'm not ashamed. It was all an experience. I am who I am today because of those experiences, and I like who I am. I wish I made better decisions, things of that nature, of course. But as far as sitting down and, you know, losing sleep over that, I don't lose sleep over none of this shit. There's one thing that tugs at me and shit from time to time, and it was a situation with kid, we call him Babyface. I wish that could have probably been handled better, you know what I'm saying? Other than that, bro, I don't really lose no sleep, man. Everything was an experience. I learned a lot. I'm able to move around. I've gained a lot of common sense. A lot of people are intelligent, but they don't have no fucking common sense. So to me, it makes them dumb as fuck. Other than that, man, not trying to sound like I don't give a fuck. Just being honest, bro. You know what I'm saying? We never did nothing out of abuse. We never bullied nobody. We never tried to take nothing from nobody. Everything we did was basically protecting ourselves, bro. You understand what I'm trying to tell you? It was either a nigga plotting to do something, you know what I'm saying, that had the courage to do it, and we wasn't gonna wait around to, you know, let a nigga do something to a nigga. You understand what I'm saying? Other than that, man, we ain't want no problem with nobody, man. We was chilling, man. You play games and we felt threatened, like they say now, you make me panic, my nigga, then what you expect me to do? Losing sleep, I don't lose sleep. I just, you know what I'm saying, wish we would have handled that Babyface situation better. That's probably the only thing that I think about and be like, damn, bro.
You know, when you think of Harlem, most people think of crews like Dame Dash and them, the best out, known for buying the bar and flossing and all that kind of stuff, man. Give us a story, man, of you, how y'all used to come through.
We was young, rich cats, B. Like, young, the operative word meaning young, bro. Like, you know, 16, 17, rich, running around, foreign whips. Still getting into all these clubs, but we were there focusing on that shit about buying no bar. We were just buying drinks for whoever and whatever, my nigga. We just did whatever, but we used to just be mobbing. Our shit was making sure you knew that we was in that club. That bottle situation came out later, you know what I'm saying? I ain't even drink, so I'm running around with bottle waters and shit, smoking butt. And there was a lot of time, like the Wild Cowboys were there in the spot that we was at, and we was wilding out and ended up turning it up in that spot. We ain't know who they was, and I've been in clubs when rappers, Chia Lee, you know, Tribe Called Quest, Flavor Unit, they in there. We notice at the end, we don't give a fuck. We doing what we want to do. We want to make sure you know that we there.
I hope you're enjoying the episode so far. There's still more to come, so keep watching. I do want to take a moment out to ask you for your support. Now, it takes a lot of time and effort for us to put together these episodes. It takes a lot of hours, a lot of days, a lot of sleepless nights. Now, we enjoy what we do, and we don't want to have to stop, man. But for some reason, our videos, they get demonetized more often than not. So it's becoming like a dice roll on the videos that we upload. So we really, really want to ask you guys for your support. Now, if you want to donate to the platform, the links are in the description box. We also have a Patreon, and we also have a Cash App. The Cash App is HollisAV202, which is HollisAV202. Now, everybody that donates to us on via the Cash App or the Patreons, whatever you pledge, whatever you donate, it can even be as little as a dollar. We're going to put your names in the credits, and we're going to shout you out in upcoming episodes. Now, the link to our Patreon is also going to be in the description box, and we're also going to pin the Cash App in the comment section as well. So once again, I want to thank you in advance for any support we get. We appreciate all the love and support that we've been getting from other platforms. Shout out to Queens Flip. Shout out to Doc Hicks. Shout out to Uncle Nick's podcast, you know. And let's get back to the video without no further delay. But once again, peace, and thank you for tuning in.
Titon, I know this might be a touchy subject, man, but I would like to get in. Maybe the viewers may want to know, what was some of the circumstances involving the shooting that when Gangsta Lou happened to get hit up back in the day? Because I'm not sure if you're familiar, Titon, is that when I did the Chango interview, I wanted to show the youth that people could move past certain type of situations without violence. People were able to put water under the bridge and just continue on with their life without somebody having to go. You understand what I'm saying? So I like to use that as an example, the same example in this situation with Gangsta Lou and you, yourself.
This is a serious talk before I even get into that. It is a touchy situation because there's real niggas involved with that. We're not trying to offend no one, you know what I'm saying? Or stir the pot, however you want to call it. That being said, shout out to Gangsta Lou, man. He kept it official through that whole situation. I can attest to that. Dudes was even took into the ambulance and he was like, nah, none of them dudes had anything to do with nothing. So he kept it G'd up all throughout the whole situation. But that being said, as it was said before, he had nothing to do with this situation whatsoever. Nothing whatsoever to do with the situation. He hollered at his people for whatever reason and got caught up in a crossfire. Thank God it wasn't a tragic situation. The reason that shit went down was because a dude from right there, 141st Street, had a baby mom that's from my neighborhood, and his baby mom happened to get into a fight with a YTC member's sister. And in the course of the fight, instead of him letting two girls resolve the situation, he got involved and slapped my man's sister. So naturally, my man reacted, and we reacted with him. And in a nutshell, that's what happened, man. But thank God it didn't escalate to anything other than what happened right there. Thank God that the people involved survived. Thank God dudes ain't end up with a bid and a case out that situation. And at G's, we've been able to coexist in the same borough on some real G shit. Respectful, not nobody bigger than nobody. Everybody respecting each other, gangster. That's basically how that went down.
So, bro, who was John Moody? Who was Blackie?
John Moody, the Upper West Side legend in his own right. He was young, getting money, flashy. He was taken out the way too fast and shit. They killed him. He was mad young. For the time he was running around, he was a pretty boy, nice kid. He getting money. He ain't known as no sucker, none of that shit, you know what I mean? He got a block, he got a hood, he running through Harlem. I remember he used to come through Booker T with the Suzuki Jeep and shit. He a little older than me and shit. I wasn't getting money like that when he was getting money. But right when we started getting money, that's when they killed him out of state. I hung out with him like once or twice. I wouldn't say he was my friend and we was calling each other today, but rest in peace to John Moody, man. Or as for Blackie, that's the big, big homie. Literally though, like not just making it sound cool, that's the big, big homie. That was Maque Tumba's big homie. That's who he looked up to and all of that. Blackie was getting a lot of money. He was actually the first one that had our block on 107 between Columbus and Manhattan. He the first one that had that shit on Smash on the crack. And then he went uptown and started selling weight. Probably a year and a half later, or two, we came in, we basically snatched up that block. A lot of people be running around acting like they know the dude and all. I be quiet and shit on certain pages. They don't really even know the nigga like that. I witnessed him doing his thing and all of that. I remember one time I had bought a 25, young like 14, my first official gun and all that. I'm hyped and all that. I see him come through, I short off. So I'm like, look what I got. I got 3 bullets. Bought this shit for $75. Only 3 bullets I got, literally. I don't even know where to go get more. But anyway, he had a full clip, but I bust off like two of them shits testing it out, whatever. I show him the gun, like, ah, look, whoa. Son, like, oh, word, this is cute right here. Boom, cock it. Bing, 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 bing. Shoot off all three shots. I'm like, oh, man, my nigga. He like, you ain't got no more. That shit, that's it? Only three shots? I'm looking at this nigga like, my nigga. Not just three shots, the only three shots, but you know, they ain't say none of that to him. I just, you know, whatever, you know what I'm saying? Ate that and all that. But yeah, Blackie, the big homie and shit, man, they killed him uptown, man, out of fear type shit, you know what I mean? Nigga got out of line, he put hands on him, and the nigga came back and caught him. I mean, you know, shit happens, bro. But Blackie definitely was running around big Benzes and all that. Rest in peace to Blackie, man, work.
And you was also with some of the top-level Wild Cowboys. Was y'all cool, and can you give us some insight on them dudes?
As for the Cowboys, the first one that I met was Pacualito at Brooklyn House. I got locked up initially on some body shit. That was just a setup to grab certain niggas off the street. That's the first nigga I met with Pacualito. He came cool, used to kick it and all that. I remember one time, nigga was a jokester and shit, but you know, I don't know, but I'm young, 20 years old. I'm on the gate talking to a dude, boom, 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 boom. This nigga get on the gate like, yo, my nigga, why you don't just shut the fuck up already? So I'm like, oh, this nigga just violated on the gate. I'm like, who the fuck you think you talking to, nigga? He like, you, man, sit the fuck down. I'm like, yo, my nigga, don't talk to me like that, my nigga. You ain't the only one to kill niggas out here, my nigga. You know, I'm talking my bullshit, like, you know, my pride is in the way. Nigga like, all right, whatever. So now I'm trying to talk to the dude. The dude like, nah, I'ma chill, I'ma chill. The dude I was talking to, he like, nah, I'ma chill, I'ma lay down, be, I'm kind of tired. I'm like, all right, fuck it. I start talking about myself on the gate, like, yeah, do that shit for like damn near an hour and 20 minutes, 30 minutes or whatever, boo, boo, boo. And then, fuck it, I lock out. I'm up before the gate crack for breakfast. As soon as the gate crack, nigga, I'm already in a sweatsuit, sneakers on, tied up. I'm ready. I ain't gonna front, I'm nervous or whatever, you know. But I'm like, nigga, this is what this shit is about. This is how this shit goes, you know what I'm saying? So I'm like, I got my shit, I'm ready, boom. So boom, gate crack, bang, I step out my cell, bang. His cell is down the block. I know he ain't come back there because I'm up already. So I look towards that way, and then I see him stepping out the cell. That nigga in slippers, his shorts, t-shirt. I'm like, oh, this nigga play me. He turn around, he see me. He like, my nigga, you ain't sleep? The whole house laughing. I was like, word? Yeah, that's the first nigga I met. Anyway, and then after that, it was Lenny came through for a little while, and Platano came through. Them niggas landed there at the same time. Then them niggas left, boom, then Fat Danny came through. And I kind of built a better relationship with Fat Danny.
Damon, tell the people who you are and where you were raised and a little bit about yourself, if you don't mind.
My name is Damon. I'm originally from Harlem, 143rd. Moved to the Bronx when I was a young kid. Met up with Tito and Pito in public school, PS 134. I was like, I am or was one of the only black dudes in the inner circle of the little crew that we had from 107th and Columbus.
Now, Damon, the Red Top crew leader, Jose Luis, was gunned down outside his apartment on 109th Street. Now, you were charged with his murder. Now, eventually, the case against you was dismissed. How did you end up being falsely blamed for his murder? And what kind of evidence did they have against you?
It's crazy about the Jose Luis situation because we were cool. Like, there's things that people didn't even know about that we was cool. Like, every time I came around, he made sure that he spoke English because he knew that I didn't speak Spanish. So he showed me that much respect by always speaking English. As far as the murder, that shit was kind of crazy because, like, we were there at Trimby's funeral, you know what I mean? Even though I was already on the run, I wanted to show my respect, so I pulled up in the cab, you know what I mean, and drove through the block. And I had seen him as he was walking down the street on his way to his crib. So later on, a few months later, we all get knocked, and all of a sudden, on the indictment, they got me down as the one who murdered him. And I was like, that shit was crazy. Like, how did that happen? Long story short, and you know, I heard like a bunch of rumors. They said, oh, it was a black dude who had killed him. And all of a sudden, they automatically said, yo, it was me. But never. Like, you know what I mean? Me and him, we had a relationship. Son was dumb cool. Like, we never had drama. We never had beef. So I didn't understand how I was even charged with it in the jump. But you know, Martin fixed it.
Say that Martin fixed it. I mean, when we say Martin, we let the people know that we're speaking of Chango. Now, when you say Chango fixed it, now, there was a rumor that Chango had a relationship with a young prosecutor, the prosecutor on you guys' case. Is there any truth to that? We all know that Chango ain't no prosecutor, nothing like that, so how can he have fixed it?
Yeah, when I speak about Martin, I'm talking about Chango. As far as the rumor about him fucking with the prosecutor chick, I was never there in the room with them. I don't know what they actually spoke about, but I just know that he had informed me that he told her that Damon didn't do it, and they dropped the case off the indictment. From my point of view, the rumor was definitely true.
Now, D, how long did you wait until the case was dismissed?
I never got a chance to bail out because I had another homicide that I was also charged with as well. I was on the island from, I got locked up June 15th, 1994. I wind up copping out to manslaughter in the first and conspiracy in the second and sentenced to 15 to 45 years. At the end of the day, when I copped out, I basically knew that I didn't have a chance to win with this case because at the end of the day, you know, a few things I actually had done. On October 31st, 1995, I took a plea deal of 15 to 45, went up north, you know, did my bid.
I appreciate you stopping by to tap in on the Brother T-Tone's episode, man. I really appreciate it, man.
I know that this is the T-Tone story. Maybe one day when we doing my story, I could tell y'all the funny story about when the whole Hun 40th and 7th Avenue tried to jump us. And me and my man, we held it down, though. But, you know, me and T-Tone got a long history. So at the end of the day, Son is a real soldier.
I want to thank the bro, Tony Sunshine, for tapping in with us, man, and blessing the platform. Now, Tony, I got a few questions for you, bro. Now, being that you're from the Bronx, New York, you know, you grew up in the 90s era, more or less my era. Did you ever hear any rumblings of the YTC in the hood? Did you ever hear any rumblings of Chang and T-Tone when you was coming up, being a Bronx native?
Of course, many times, coming from where we come from and, you know, just being young boys sitting around and having conversations with some of the street legends and things of that nature. And names came up numerous amount of times.
Tell the people, man, what you got going on, what you've been up to.
So I got that new Shots Fired single out right now. It's doing pretty well. People are loving it. Just shot the video. The video be at you soon. Just like I was telling Titong and telling a couple of the fellas and all that, song was actually inspired by me sitting down and watching a bunch of documentaries. So I was sitting in the crib one day, going through YouTube, going through a couple of other social media outlets, and I came across InfoMines, and I watched a bunch of Titong and Chango documentaries, as well as a lot of other street legends interviews, and I got inspired to write Shots Fired. You know, I went to the studio with Titong, Chang, and everyone else that I had watched the night before in mind, and the rest is history. Shots Fired was born. But we got more of that, where that came from, and we just working, man.
I appreciate you tapping in on my brother Titon's episode. We reached out to you. You got right back at us, man. No Hollywood shit. Once again, my brother Tony Sunshine. Now, Sadat, can you tell us your connection with Titon and Chang, the two co-leaders of the YTC? Now, both Titon and Chang, they spoke very highly of you.
My recollection of Chang and Titon was, I remember I was living over there on Hunt 6. You know, they was in the area. One of my little dudes, Sean Black, who's on the Wild Cowboys album, he was messing with one of them sides. I forgot who it was, but he was out there. I just remember, like, they was young, man. They was like some young dudes, and they was getting a lot of money over there. I just was buying smoke over there, and I remember they had the whole area with the smoke. So I did some smoke over there, but I was, like, observing, seeing how they was moving, and, you know, I was like, yo, these boys over here got it in the smash. They had a different flow on this side, on that Amsterdam, Columbus side. They was getting a lot of money.
You mentioned Sean Black. Sean Black was a YTC associate that you gave a record deal. Can you elaborate on that as well?
Sean Black went to Graphic Arts High School. You know, I met him through, I used to get my hair cut at Sam Gore's over there on 145th. My man Bird used to cut my hair. He was young then, he was in high school. And he was like, yo, my man Sean Black is nice, boom, bang, he's nice. And I used to be like, well, yo, where you at? He was like, yo, you over there on Amsterdam, Columbus, over there doing what he do. So he took me over there a couple of times. I was like, son, it's nice. I remember he got popped up. And, you know, Black was nice. Black's still nice. You know, he just went through the problems that he went through, but he was definitely nice, and he was out there. Definitely want to give a shout out to T-Tone, give a shout out to Chang, definitely, and let people, I remember them days, man, and you know, we came up out of there, we lost a lot of dudes got lost in that.
whether to jail or just getting sent back, getting murdered. A lot of murders went on at that time. I remember the funeral home up there was a funeral and niggas shot out at the funeral. Good thing that dudes came up out of there. Respect out to YTC, you know what I'm saying? I remember that, definitely. Major force in New York history, street history. You can't talk New York street history without mentioning them boys. I'm glad them two brothers is still here. You know, it is what it is.
Shout out to the guards, to .X, Don Rosaveli on this side. Appreciate the fact that you tapping in, big homie. I remember the black Wrangler, you coming through, brand new, being popping heavy. But thank you for tapping in, big homie.
Now, Tone, look, bro, the internet been buzzing lately, especially as far as the East Coast goes. You know, you've had some of the original UBN founding members on the Queens Flip Show, and they were just talking about the relations with the Latino inmates and the black inmates at the time. What was the climate like? Because we all know that you got sentenced in 94, if I ain't mistaken. So you had to be on Rikers Island at the same time all this shit was going on. Can you give us a take on what the fuck was going on from your perspective and the type of shit that you were seeing?
I was in the CMC houses and shit. That's high classified cases. Big high profile cases basically ended up there. That's where Fat Cat, Pappy, like they put high classified notorious niggas according to their standards and shit. Deadeye was in a Brooklyn house with me, so I knew Deadeye personally. We bit it, it was cool. Never had no problem. Actually, I was in 1B. I was in 182, Bing and HDM, and that's basically was Bloodhouse. If you was Hispanic, you couldn't even go out to the yard. And I was in the yard one day, I'm like, what's up? Like, ain't shit, you got cigarettes? Like, nah, I ain't no cigarettes. Like, yo, go to the yard, see you out there, cool, boom. Went to the yard, he was there with some other young blood kid, and they just started wilding on the court, cutting everything Spanish. And the kid was coming towards me, and he was like, nah, not the homie. Fuck how I would've reacted and what I would've did afterwards. A nigga could've cut me, he would've cut me. He would've not said something. I probably would've had a scar on me right now. Thank God I don't have that. But yeah, shit was tense for them people that was gangbanging. I wasn't gangbanging. I was on a totally different lane. But yeah, B, shit was serious around there, man. It was like a race war. I got friends that's Bloods. I got friends that's Kings. I got friends that's everything. Because, you know, it wasn't really about who you was down. It was just about how you was moving at that moment or whatever the case may be.
Now, bro, we know you just went through a situation, a legal situation. Can you just elaborate to the people what you're going through, what's going on with you right now?
Yeah, man. Unfortunately, I gotta go sit down, meaning I gotta turn myself in. I just pled guilty to 4 joints. I gotta go in for sentencing and shit. That's one of the things that I want the young boys to understand, man, that a lot of times when you get caught up in the system, you really gotta know how to just stay out the way. I learned from this situation that I can't associate with people that are doing whatever they're doing if that shit is illegal, even though I may not be doing it because due to my history, my past, it's easy to spin a story or get caught up in a mix-up. I just shouldn't have been hanging and interacting with third individual, not because they bad people, but because it was a conflict of interest of the way that they was living and I was living, you dig? So, yeah, I gotta go sit down, man. I got caught up in a wiretap conspiracy. It's that simple right now to just get caught up in some bullshit, man. Ain't no future in the streets, my brother.
What would you say to the kid right now at that crucial stage in life, at that crossroad in life, that's gonna make that left turn to the streets or it's gonna make that right turn and do the right thing in life?
It ain't that you may not make it. Just ain't really worth it, you dig? That's what I be telling the youngins. It's not worth losing your freedom for money. You have $1 million, you're gonna pay that shit in bail. If they gave you $1 million bail and you was locked up and you had $1 million, you're gonna pay it. So it's not worth, you know. And again, I'm not a paragon of virtue. I get caught up in shit, but today I get caught up in shit because of my name, the notoriety. It gives promotion, it sells newspapers, and it's just a fact. It's how it is.
At the end of the day, my brother, the purpose for me saying this story is so individuals that can relate, youth at risk, my peers, anyone that could relate, man, male, female, could learn from my mistake. I know it sounds cliche. The most powerful people, man, are people that learn from experience, not just their own experience, experiences of others as well, that they could determine as being valid. So all I'm doing is giving y'all my story validly. I don't know if that's a word, but you know what I'm talking about. My shit valid, not glorifying. That shit ain't leave me a pension. I'm still grinding. I'm still moving forward. I'm just appreciative that I survived that era, the crack wars, as they called them back then. So my purpose, my objective is to say my story in the hopes that when someone hears it, they can relate and they can make a better decision if they need to be making a decision at that moment. You dig? Like if they're at a crossroad, my experience may be able to guide them on the right path.
So, bro, tell the people where they can find you at. Tell the people your social media handles. You know what I mean? Anybody you want to big up, anybody you want to shout out, anything you want to shine a spotlight on. Before we wrap it up, once again, I appreciate you, big dog. Your message is needed. The reason we use guys like yourself and colorful characters, from these different areas and these different neighborhoods all across the globe is because people are more receptive for the information that you guys give, and they're more receptive of people that actually walk the walk and have talked the talk and have been lucky enough to survive, or they've come to a different mind state to where they turned their life around, and now you're trying to, you know, give a positive message and let the kids know, man, the street life, it's a lot of hang-ups, man. I'm glad that we got guys like you to set the record straight for the shorties, man.
I appreciate the opportunity. I appreciate you putting your platform at my disposal. Just to say it again, bro, it's not worth it, man, putting a price tag on your freedom. I want to sign off by basically shouting out Top Guala, M Guala Movimiento. You know what I'm saying? Guala Life Brugal Boys. You dig? Yacht Masters, established in 2016. We got the hottest yacht party in New York City. In the summer, we provide an environment for everybody to party. Never had no problem, thank God. Nothing but an official G party. And Taguala and Guala, they got music, Guala Life, YouTube, IG. And if you want to find me, man, Titon Rosaveli, TitonRosavelli. You dig? And go to that Kids at Work page, man. The script is written for the movie. And I hope that the kids really learn from this situation and don't think that I'm trying to scare you out the situation. Y'all might make it in jail or whatever, but that's not the point. That's a loss. The win is staying here with your family, man, with your loved ones, doing what you want when you want, eating what you want when you want, showering when you want. You understand what I'm saying? Being able to spend time with a loved one, cuddle, things of that nature, man. Have a refrigerator, watch TV all night if you want. You dig? And again, thank you, man, for providing me the opportunity. Blessings, my brother, to you and everybody, man. Hope everybody gets what they want out of life.